Here we have a Gustav Becker. The clock just simply stops once in a while. Doesn't want to keep running. This is kind of typical of what you'll see out there. See kind of like the knots and all. They were hurriedly done. I like making them a little more special. The case of the Gustav Becker, it's a little on the rough side. It looks like it was patched together by another clockmaker. This top piece does not look original. Need to take a look at that mechanism, make sure that it's running correctly. Before we take apart this Gustav Becker, we have to realize its unique way of making the snail and activating the strike actually functions. Instead of putting the snail on the minute arbor like other manufacturers, they chose to put it on a separate arbor, and it is activated by a little pin. The previous repairer had several scratch marks on this wheel already, but they didn't align to anything. They were all misaligned, so I made myself a new set that actually aligned right there. Here's an interesting feature of the higher-end clocks. As you can see, the winding arbor is nothing tremendous, except it's a well-made strike-side winding arbor. Very delicate, but very functional. Well, here we are out of the ultrasonic, and I just laid the parts out. All of these parts are external to the plates, and all of these parts are internal to the plates. I even included the little levers. There's nothing more frustrating than putting together the movement and forgetting the levers, so make sure you separate them. Popped in all the wheels, and that's what she looks like, and you can see the fly governor over here. Remember the going power I told you about on the time side winding arbor? It has a little spring on the inside. Well, that spring needs to rest up against this little outside gear with teeth on it, and this is the little pawl that stops it from rotating backwards when you're winding the movement. Make sure you put this guy back in there, otherwise that spring cannot function properly. They sell this cord in three different sizes. This is the medium size. It is a severely a braided multi-strand cord. It is so strong, it's incredible, and it does not stretch. It's probably better quality than what was on here previously. Okay, we have the front plate is secured by the brand new tapered pins. I cut them to size, and now we're lining up the timing marks. I did a preliminary adjustment of the movement within of its bracket that I removed from the clock case. I adjusted the hammer so it clears everything. Well, it's starting to take shape. I cleaned it up, put a little bit of oil on it, bringing it back to life. Quite a bit different than before, don't you think? Here we got the movement, and I'm going to be installing the dial back onto it. Installing the hands, and make sure that the second hand must not be jamming up against the dial itself. Here I have the movement installed. I have it in the most forward position because it's held in by two screws which are in slots. I have it in the most forward position. Okay, we put in the new suspension spring, and now when the pendulum rises up to where it should be swinging, it won't be hitting that crutch assembly. Since this clock has extra hooks to hook up the other side of the weights to the bottom of the movement, I decided to put in a single overhand knot followed by a double overhand knot. And I'm going to cut the excess of the string away. And then I'm going to put a little bit of CA, which is crazy glue to some people, onto the knot itself so it doesn't get undone. And since there won't be any movement between that piece of brass and the string, it pretty much should last forever. And it also makes it easy for the customer to hook and unhook the cord from the bottom of the movement. I still need to do some preliminary adjustments and all, but I'm just going to let it run for the night. And as you can see, it's running under its own power now. I just have it on a temporary test stand to keep everything at eye level.